Welcome to Talk of the Bay. I'm Christine Barrington. Well, it's a dynamic time for Santa Cruz County transportation. While the Regional Transportation Commission celebrates the groundbreaking of the Highway 1 auxiliary lane, bus on shoulder, and Mar Vista bike and pedestrian overcrossing, a lawsuit has been filed by the Sierra Club and the Campaign for Sustainable Transportation seeking to halt the Highway 1 expansion in Aptos. My guests are Campaign for Sustainable Transportation co-chair Rick Longinotti, along with Lonnie Faulkner, member of the Sierra Club Executive Committee and founder of Equity Transit. Rick and Lonnie, thank you so much for joining me on Talk of the Bay.
Glad to be here. Thank you, Christine.
Yeah. It's great to be here.
All right. Let me turn you up a little bit. So before we get into this topic, I wonder, Rick, if you could just give a brief introduction to our listeners who aren't in the know. What is the Campaign for Sustainable Transportation?
Yeah, so the campaign was organized in 2002 when there was a plan to expand Highway 1, actually to double the size of Highway 1. And it was advocating for alternatives to highway expansion, alternatives such as, you know, prioritizing transit, and also having safe streets for everybody, for pedestrians, for bicyclists. We have a lot of parents in our community who quite rightly don't feel safe in letting their children ride their bike to school. You know, we could really change that if we had a mind to do that.
Right. Okay. Excellent. And then Lonnie, you are, so the Sierra Club Ventana chapter is the one that is partnering with the Campaign for Sustainable Transportation, or is it the state Sierra Club that is partnering in this lawsuit?
Actually, it goes all the way up to the state and even national, right? In this case, Rick?
Yeah, the national had to approve the lawsuit.
Yeah, before any lawsuit can be even though it may be initiated at the local level, it has to go all the way up to be approved, all the way up to the national level. So that's a pretty significant statement.
It is a really significant statement. So actually, let's jump into this. Rick, what is this lawsuit about, and when exactly was it filed?
Okay, well, we filed the lawsuit on March 18th, and it's regarding a segment of the highway expansion. Folks in this county are familiar with construction going on the highway right now. The construction is happening between Soquel Drive and 41st Avenue. And the construction is to build an auxiliary lane. Auxiliary lanes are lanes that are otherwise known as exit-only lane, where you have to get off if you're in that lane. So their plan is to construct those auxiliary lanes from Santa Cruz all the way down to State Park Drive. And those are all fully funded and approved. So that construction is going to happen over the next year or two. And then the lawsuit that we filed is regarding a next segment, which is from State Park Drive to Freedom Boulevard, the auxiliary lanes that they plan to do there. Those are not fully funded. The voters in 2016, there was a Measure D that was passed that would fund the first set of auxiliary lanes, but not this set. The Regional Transportation Commission voted, I think 2021, to amend this expenditure plan to partially fund this set, but they're still between $80 and $100 million short of funding this. So between a funding shortage and the lawsuit, there are big obstacles to getting this done.
I just want to add to that, by the way, as a part of 2016, from what I understand, actually only the first auxiliary lane was as a part of Measure D 2016, which was the Soquel exit.
Yeah, it was from Soquel to State Park. Those were part of Measure D.
I thought that, and I'm sorry I'm questioning this, but I thought that that latter portion from Soquel to State Park Drive was approved after the fact at the RTC.
Not correct. It was all part of that expenditure plan. So 4 miles were approved. Yeah.
Right. And that's an example of just how complex and hard to sort out all these different sections and facts are. And so listeners might be wondering, like, okay, so we've got these auxiliary lanes planned and funded up to a point. So why be upset about another section of auxiliary lanes? Can you speak to that?
Sure. I mean, I think the question before that is like, what good are auxiliary lanes? How do they help us? Caltrans has a design manual for highways. And they say when there's are two interchanges that are close together, like they're 2,000 feet apart, you should put an auxiliary lane for safety. And that allows cars to merge on to the highway and to get off the highway more safely because there's a lane. We know that experience well on our highway because the original highway was built with an auxiliary lane between 41st Avenue and Bay Porter. That's a perfect example of one designed for safety. These auxiliary lanes in question, the ones that are under construction and the ones that we're suing about, were not motivated by a safety motivation. In fact, the environmental impact report that analyzed the whole stretch of auxiliary lanes found that the accident rates would remain the same after building these auxiliary lanes. So what are they for? Well, they were proposed to be for congestion relief. Everybody wants congestion relief. Again, that EIR that analyzed the whole stretch from Santa Cruz to Freedom Boulevard found that there would be, in the quote, no significant safe congestion relief due to the auxiliary lanes. So that raises the question, why are we doing this? And we're finally getting around to having the funding and the backing to be able to stop it where it is now.
Okay, so what I'm hearing you say is that our county is set to expend $80 million and above for this auxiliary. How much is the cost?
So this last segment is $180 million plus. The segments before that, I don't have the numbers. They're not as expensive because they're mostly widening in between the overpasses. This one has to replace two rail bridges, has to cross, change the bridge structure over two creeks, and
so just to be in the shoes of an average listener. So what I'm hearing you say is this stretch in Aptos that the lawsuit is about would cost around $180 million.
Yeah, that was the figure that the Regional Transportation Commission gave up until just a couple weeks ago. They took that number down. I think the number's gone up. They haven't put a new number up there yet.
But somewhere's around that much.
Figure 200 million,
right.
Yeah.
Right. And so somehow the Regional Transportation Commission of Santa Cruz County and the state has the will to say, we're going to fund this auxiliary lane, even though according to the Campaign for Sustainable Transportation, the Sierra Club, say it's not really going to serve much purpose. Am I getting the logic right?
Well, it's not just us, you know.
Yeah.
Linda Wilsherson, who was the executive director of the Regional Transportation Commission for 20 years up until about 2006. She wrote comments on the environmental impact report on this segment.
Yeah.
She says, according to the data, this does not relieve congestion in a meaningful way, and therefore the goals of the project are not met.
Yeah, it's not logical, and it's a tremendous expenditure, and we're not going to get into this in the show, but I'm just reflecting on how, county supervisors just rejected, the rail trail because of a much smaller potential expenditure. So these are huge numbers, and so it would seem that our county would need to have really good reasons for wanting to spend that kind of money. So, but we've got much more to talk about related to this lawsuit. So, okay, you've established that the auxiliary lane probably isn't going to serve a logical function. So tell us a little bit more about the lawsuit and why you filed it. I bet there's even more reasoning in there.
Well, so it's like, as we had a little meeting in Aptos, 40 people showed up at the Aptos Library on Saturday. And as I said to them, if you had the news that the whole stretch of 9 miles of auxiliary lanes would not relieve congestion, would you be excited about building auxiliary lanes? Well, nobody indicated any excitement. So why would they go ahead? I think the motivation is that traffic congestion is so annoying to so many people, but it's a very intractable problem. Our transportation experts say that you can't just add a lane to a highway and expect to solve it because more cars show up and that phenomenon of induced travel. Even less so with auxiliary lanes, that's not even a through lane.
Right.
You still have the choke points at each interchange. So when you have an intractable problem and you don't know what to do about it, you make a show of doing something about it. I think that's, it sounds cynical, but I think that's the motivation. Like, let's pretend that we're doing something about this problem.
And I think that along with the problem that we're creating in potentially doing these auxiliary lanes, you're also talking about cutting down a tremendous amount of trees. So there's the issue there. And then we're refocusing huge amounts of monies away from potential alternatives. And if we're going to address climate change and the issues that are bigger than just immediate traffic, we need to look at the whole from a systems approach, which is, how can we get people out of cars? How can we reduce vehicle miles traveled? Right. How can we actually create more alternatives that people are excited about using? And if we're going to pour money into highway widening or auxiliary lanes in particular, which don't help with traffic in a very short period of time, we're taking money away from a lot of other alternatives that we can pour money into right now.
Right. And that whole vehicle miles traveled, like, the, again, let's be in the seat of the average listener. And they're like, what does that mean? Vehicle miles traveled. What's the importance of that? Now, there was a big University of California wide study involving several campuses, scores of researchers. And they make the case, we have to reduce vehicle miles traveled. So explain, who would like to explain to our listeners what that means and why it matters?
So it just means traffic. It just means the amount of cars on the road for, you know, and the length of time that cars are on the road. So, and everybody wants to reduce traffic. I think to the last person, everybody would like to reduce traffic. And as Lonnie pointed out, the way to do that is alternatives. When you talk to the transportation experts, another former regional transportation commission director, George Dondero, did it. He asked Susan Handy, an expert at UC Davis in transportation studies. He said, what do we do for people who are stuck in traffic, who need to get from the south to the north county? And she said, give them alternatives. And that means transit, perhaps transit on the rail corridor, a bus-only lane on Highway 1, which they could do now because they're paving for an auxiliary lane. They could convert that to a bus-only lane. Increasing the transit frequency. As Jarrett Walker, the transportation expert from Portland, told us, you folks need more frequent transit.
Right. Yeah. So as you know, and maybe some of our listeners know, I did a whole series on the rail trail. And one of the people I interviewed was Supervisor Felipe Hernandez's assistant, Celeste Gutierrez. And she was pointing out that, gee, the bus service from Watsonville was still only running every 30 minutes when people in Watsonville are some of the most impacted by these traffic patterns. So what right now my understanding is that Metro Santa Cruz has been increasing bus service to some extent. Is there anything you want to say? Lonnie, you're nodding your head.
Yeah,
you speak to
Michael
that?
Tree came in about 2 years ago and has done an absolutely superb job, truly visionary, and worked with Jarrett Walker, who came in 2018 and did say very clearly that we should be prioritizing increasing our bus service, both on Highway 1, Soquel, and all across, you know, the county. Of course,
Michael Tree's general manager.
Prior general manager. Of course, he's just recently left, and we'll have a new general manager come in and hopefully move forward with the same plan. But when you're talking about equity and the environment, I mean, these are crossover issues, is that to address equity, you have to provide a lot of options because a lot of people can't afford to drive cars. I hear people often respond, well, you know, if you don't widen the highway, people who are construction workers can't go on the highways. But what people are not seeing is that the majority of people who need to get to and from work may not need trucks. You take them into alternatives and they're taking the bus and they're getting to and from work on bus. Then the people who have to use the trucks to go to construction work will have less traffic to deal with. So it benefits everybody across the board as well as our environment.
Right. And so We'll be returning to this idea of more transit alternatives, but I would love to ask, what do you hope that this lawsuit is going to achieve, and what are the parameters of what it's...
So basically the lawsuit is it asks that Caltrans follow the law. We consider their evasion of a requirement that's a new requirement as of 2020 to measure vehicle miles traveled, and that means analyzing how many new vehicles are going to show up when you've widened a road. And they did not do that. They may admit in their environmental impact report that they didn't do that according to their new requirements. They're claiming an exemption. So we're challenging that. We said, no, you're not exempt. And so if we win the lawsuit, they would have to not only analyze this increase in traffic, but they would have to mitigate it. That's what the law says. So mitigation could be putting money into our bus system or, you know, active transportation, bicycling and pedestrian infrastructure. So it would cost them a whole lot more. So, but actually that's not our goal, is just to get more money for these other good things. Our goal is really to provoke a moment of reconsideration when the Regional Transportation Commission leaders sit down and go, is this really what we want? We barely paid attention to the fact that this is not going to help. In fact, the EIR says that congestion will be worse in the morning commute northbound. So cars that are backed up will be backed up even further. So they're not paying attention to that. So it's just moving along like it has its own momentum. So we want a day of reckoning, a day of reconsideration. That's the goal of this lawsuit.
And I think, too, if you look past at past studies, Unified Corridor Study and some of the other studies that were done, you want to look at economics, environment, and equity. And it just seems like we've come up with these great studies that have these ways of practice. And one of the things they said is our next priority was to look at creating more robust public transportation and in the ways of doing that. And it's almost as though the more recent RTC has executive director, who's not with us now, is ignoring those findings, ignoring their own guidelines.
Yeah, it seems that highway expansion is privileged, that it's got sort of a psychological momentum. We're used to highways. We're used to believing cars are the way we get around. And so people aren't seriously questioning the logic of what's going on. So like I hear a lot of talk, so I know we're not going to get into the rail system in depth here, but I constantly am hearing, oh, it's too expensive. It's too expensive to use our rail corridor. It's too expensive to put in a rail system. But I don't hear people like tallying the numbers of how much it costs to widen a highway, even though it won't solve the problem. Mm-hmm. And yet somehow that mantra doesn't hold. You know, highway expansion seems kind of privileged.
And it's not even the widening. It's actually, as you talk about, maintenance over time. I mean, the costs of maintaining highways and roadways are so much more expensive compared to other options. So, you know, that's just, again, it's that looking at the entire system together.
I think, you know, thanks to your radio show and other ways that we're getting the word out, as people discover what's at stake here and that the Caltrans EIR says there's no congestion relief benefit that of any lasting value, I don't care if you're left, right, or center. Nobody wants to spend money on something that's ineffective. This is an issue that cuts across left and right. And it should, it should, you know. And now it's just a question of, can we, you know, wake up in time to save some money so that we can make our streets safer? Like, we're in the state of California has an Office of Traffic Safety, and they keep statistics on the 58 counties in California. We're number two worst in the rate of injuries to bicyclists, and we're the fifth worst in rate of injuries to pedestrians. That's a statistic that none of us should be accepting. But it's going to take some money to change that, to make our streets safer.
It'll also take a philosophical change. So a lot of times when I was meeting people in the last year at the door, a lot of people spoke to how upset they were that it is so unsafe, that their kids can't bike to school anymore. I mean, there was a time when kids could bike to school easily and safely. right now, I can tell you, even on my 25 mile an hour road right in front of my house, people drive 60 miles an hour. I've seen kids practically hit. People flip you off if you try to cross the street. We have to change our whole community's way of thinking and ask ourselves the question, do we value speed of our cars over the safety of everybody? You know, I sit on the Community Traffic Safety Coalition. We know every third day someone's either seriously injured or killed on our streets. Mm-hmm. And that's a huge statistic. It's worse than gun violence. It's so significant, and yet because we don't understand it or we don't see it in front of us, when someone shoots a gun, you hear about it. But when someone's hit with a car, it's kind of in the wash in the news. You may or may not hear about it. And so really bringing it forward, places like Portland, a friend of mine from Portland came and he said, you know, on their streets, they've gotten surface streets at 20 miles an hour. Places in Europe know that if you keep it around 30 kilometers, which is about 18 to 20 miles an hour, if someone is hit, which the likelihood decreases, and you have great infrastructure that slows your commuters down, if people are hit, they don't die. And we need to get to that point. We need to prioritize people's safety in our community.
Yeah, and that whole transformation of mindset is hugely important. And we're going to take a short break, and when we come back, we're going to talk more about the perils of highway widening to our pocketbook and our community's safety, and not only that, but quality of life. So we'll be back with more with Rick Longinotti of the Campaign for Sustainable Transportation and Lonnie Faulkner, who is on the executive committee of the Sierra Club and has founded Equity Transit.
Rumba, salsa, bomba, son un tuno, cumbia, merengue, guaguanco. Tune in to K-Squid 90.7 FM Tuesday nights at 10 p.m. for Calamar and Salsa. Alex Ferrer, the Salsa PI, brings you the best Afro-Caribbean music ever recorded. You can also stream live or from the archives at ksqd.org. KSQD, many voices, one station, community radio for Santa Cruz, the Monterey Bay Area, and beyond.
Yeah, Renny, go on, baby.
KSQD offers four weekly programs of classical music. Saturday mornings from 6 to 9, it's Music of the Masters with Joe Truscott. On Sunday, also 6 to 9, Christopher Smith brings you Classical Tune-Up, followed right after by Nicholas Mitchell with the Sunday Morning Classical Foglift until 11. For opera lovers, there's Monday Night at the Opera, hosted by Joe Truscott, 7 to 10 p.m. On special evenings during this same time slot, Joe brings you Concert Hall, a presentation of local classical concert performances right here on KSQD Santa Cruz 90.7.
And Nicholas Mitchell there was talking about Concert Hall, and tonight is one of our special nights. Tonight at 7 p.m., KSQD presents our monthly Concert Hall, but with Christopher Smith. He's going to be featuring the recent concert of the Santa Cruz Baroque Festival's 51st season, Virtuoso Bach by Candlelight, and it features solo organ compositions by Bach with virtuoso performances by organist Jörg Redden. Redden holds the very same choral director and organist position in Arnstadt, Germany, as the 18-year-old Johann Sebastian Bach did three centuries ago. It is sure to be a very, very special program. Light your candles, dim the lights, and enjoy Concert Hall with Christopher Smith. That's tonight, 7 to 10 p.m. only on KSQD 90.7 FM, 89.7 FM, which is community radio for all of the Monterey Bay. And this is Talk of the Bay. I'm Christine Barrington, and tonight we are talking about a lawsuit that has been filed by the Campaign for Sustainable Transportation and the Sierra Club. And the lawsuit involves the Aptos highway widening, particularly the auxiliary lane, is what we've been talking about, right, Rick? And so before we went to break, Lonnie, you were talking about that for us to deal with you know, this privileging of highway widening, the car culture, and pivoting our public dollars toward things that actually make a difference, which are safety for pedestrians and bicyclists, more frequent bus service, and in particular, of course, I'm going to say, utilizing our amazing rail corridor, which is such a tremendous possibility, but it takes money. And if we're spending all our money on the highway, we don't have money for other things. So before we went to break, you know, you were talking about this. And so I'm wondering, what is required for that change of mindset? What are some of the things that you know could help us shift our mindset?
Well, I put a lot of weight in our young people because young people really get it. A lot of young people now don't want to necessarily have to drive. A lot of younger people are moving to cities that have robust public transportation, or even in town, they're making choices around that. And it feels more like older people who tend to drive their cars everywhere and haven't really had the muscle around using public transit are kind of disconnected from the ease of use, or if you haven't traveled a lot. How to make that change is really getting young people more involved. And then we have older folks who make choices, like Rick and friends like Pauline Seals, who I know you've interviewed as well, who make the active choice to ride a bike as much as possible around town. I try to do that as well. And then just talking about it as much as possible. I think there's a whole sector of people in our community that it is really hard to change their understanding of the importance of that.
Yeah, and I think also one of the ways we change mindset is exactly through lawsuits, right? Is like forcing it into the public consciousness and forcing a decision. Like, I have a question from the press release.
Can I
yes,
interrupt
and
you?
Please, I wanted to. That's your job. It's my
right,
guest
thanks.
Is to interrupt me.
so I think, you know, about how we change. Again, back to Jarrett Walker, so the transit planner from Portland. When he came here, he said, you know, you need to do the little things like bus shelters. You know, if somebody's going to ride the bus and it's out there raining and they're not going to ride the bus next time, you know, you need to make buses easy to board, level platforms, ticketing that's off board, so that, you know, people can get on and off quickly, and it makes the whole thing more efficient. The buses need to go where people need, you know, want to go. They need to be safe. If you do those things, he used the word incremental. He said, if you do all the incremental things, people will use it. It's like you provide something that's competitive with getting around by the car, and competitive with price as well. If you are living in Watsonville, the average household spends 20% of its income on transportation, an enormous sum of money. And that's because there is no other choice. We're shackled to our automobiles. There's no other way to get around that's practical. So if you provide a practical solution, we were talking a few minutes ago about a lane on the highway that's devoted to buses. A bus right now on Highway 1 can get from Watsonville to Santa Cruz at the county building in 36 minutes. That's in the middle of the day when that's not a peak period. So if it had its own lane, it could make comparable time, and that becomes competitive, especially when cars are stuck in traffic. So if you provide it and people will come, that's a way to change mindset. And as Lonnie said, I think that the young people who, they're not as enamored with automobiles as my generation, you know, that's not so romantic. It's more of a pain. They see how hard it is to
And it's expensive, you know, $10,000 to $14,000 a year to spend to keep up a car. My friend, who isn't a young person but is older than me, just came from Portland, makes the active choice to take public transit when he comes. So trains or BARTs, or, you know, makes it all the way from the airport to here. And having just flown into New York last year and then also to Cleveland, I mean, it was just amazing to be able to drop into the airport, having flown, and then to be able to get where you need to go through their local train and bus. It's amazing to be able to do that and to have hands-free and not have to rent a car.
It is amazing. When I lived in Vienna, Austria for 4 years, and we stupidly shipped our car with us because we were dumb young Americans. And when my husband's company sent us over, we had a car. We never used it. $400 a year got us a Jahreskarte, and we could go anywhere in the city we needed to go, and even when it was minus 30 degrees and snow and blizzards were happening, we used public transit because it was easy, it worked, and it is really, I don't know, it's really empowering to know you can get out of your car when you want to. Mm-hmm. And so, yes, making these, you're right, making these incremental changes. I interviewed a blind woman who described how much time she has sat waiting for buses and waiting and waiting and waiting, and not only that, unprotected. And so you're right. And so is it, I'm making up a story, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, if we're spending all this money widening our highway, we don't have money for these excellent incremental changes.
I think it's pretty simple, Christine. You nailed it, you know. I mean, the biggest problem is the opportunity missed by spending all the money where we're spending it. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, and it takes money. Again, it's that equity piece where you talked about, you know, our friends who are have disabilities, whether they're blind or they just can't. I mean, my friend who is blind, her husband, if he is unable or unhealthy and unable to drive her to a medical appointment, she has to go by bus, but she actually prefers to go by bus because that gives her freedom.
Yes.
And so I hear a lot of people who don't understand the value of public transit and freedom. Think about young people who can't drive. They can actually get around by public transit. Right. People who are older who no longer feel comfortable or safe driving can get around by public transit. And people who cannot or unable to drive themselves are able to get around on public transit when that transit is available and robust. And that's why, you know, prioritizing that actually gives more options for more people.
Yeah, and I interviewed one of our regional transportation commissioners, Kristen Brown, and she indicated that very soon they were going to be making bus rides free.
Yes, yes. Yeah. I think it's a pilot for about 3 years. And I think, first of all, they've made, you know, we had Pauline Seals with her Youth for Climate Justice group, and they really worked hard to try to get statewide free transit for youth, which I think was great. And then we worked here with Michael Tree. They got free transit here locally. And what that helps to do is it builds that muscle in our young people to using transit. And then hopefully the same thing will happen as we bring free transit, as Metro brings free transit for 3 years. It'll enable people to have a choice and make it easier and more affordable for folks to hop on board.
Anything you want to add there, Rick, before I get back to this lawsuit?
Well, you mentioned Vienna. I enjoyed that story. Thanks. And I'm thinking in the United States, Boulder. I've not been to Boulder, but it's a university town. 25% of the people arrive at their jobs downtown on the bus. And here it's about 3%. You know, so what's the difference? Like, what are we not doing that Boulder is doing? That's been a question that's occupied me. And one of the answers is that they have a bus pass in Boulder that if you work in the downtown, you get a bus pass. Or businesses are outside of the downtown, they can buy in bulk at a discount. They can buy for their employees.
Right.
And so there are now hundreds of businesses that provide bus passes for their employees. So it really works. Boulder also has a higher rate of commuters by bicycle than downtown Santa Cruz. They have just a safer bike infrastructure. So it's a matter of their leaders. I saw a video about Boulder, and it turns out that their leaders around the early 90s really made a decision. We want a bus system that's not just for poor people and students, and they put their money into it.
Mm-hmm. And it's really interesting, as Equity Transit hat, I talk a lot about the history in our country, right? We actually once had the world's best public transit system in the world. We were well ahead of the game, as in so many ways the United States was the head of the game. And then really it was just these small, I should say, they were powerful organizations, the tire, automobile, asphalt, trucking industry, that really concertedly destroyed our public transit system. Mm-hmm. And then at that time, other places like Europe just took off and overshadowed us. And I think that those moneyed interests continue to play a role in our culture, unfortunately. But we as people, I say, you know, marketing is such a strong suit, right? We equate the car with being sexy, being powerful. And, you know, you have the marketing and the commercials. And it's a real hard thing for people to get over that concept. And then our infrastructure as well has been totally designed for the car, so we really have to look at multiple ways of restructuring things.
Right, and the Reagan administration rewrote the laws so that we don't have robust funding for public transit, and it makes it very hard. And then there's constantly this marketing message, you know, oh, it's going to cost the taxpayers money. It's amazing to me how often that's like thrown out there. The taxpayers are going to be concerned about this. And it's like, wait a minute, this is investment. And we do need to tell the story very powerfully. Public transit returns on investment in a big, big way.
That's a really great point, because we know American APTA, American Public Transportation Association, for every $1 we spend on robust public transit in our communities, it actually brings back $5. And we see that time and time again. So it is just kind of shifting people's understanding of how it benefits everybody in our communities.
Yeah, it's said that theories divide people and stories unite them. Mm-hmm. And if you can tell a good story, you can usually get the people on your side. And that is part of what we do here in radio, is we try to tell good stories. And so, Rick, I want to bunny hop back to this lawsuit. How is this lawsuit going to tell a good story? And what can the public expect? Like, how might it proceed? How is it going to work?
Yeah. Well, one of the interesting just happenstance is that the best attorney to sue Caltrans, maybe in the state of California, lives in Aptos. And he likes where he lives, and he worked his offices in Aptos. He doesn't want to see 1,100 trees mowed down, including beautiful redwood trees alongside the highway. So he's into this lawsuit. He is into it, and he's giving us, a good deal in terms of the money that we're supposed to come up with. I think that people in Aptos that we met on Saturday at the Aptos Library, they love the beauty of their community, and they don't want to see that harmed, especially when they find out that it's being harmed for so little benefit, or if any benefit. It's one thing to sort of, you know, be willing to sacrifice something of your own neighborhood or whatever if it's benefiting the public good. But when it's not, it's meaningless. So we're hopeful that the two candidates for supervisor in that district that represent Aptos will really heed, you know, what the people are saying about what they want in that community.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And, you know, as I think about, you know, just again, to tell the story, you know, multimodal transportation options optimize the vehicle's use. So, you know, if you've got a bus with a lot of people in it, you know, vehicles like buses and cars, they put off brake dust, they put off rubber pollution that goes into our waterways. In people would be shocked at the amount of destruction caused by these byproducts. And so getting people out of their cars, walking safely, biking safely, you know, inhabiting buses in large numbers, and again, getting in a train along a corridor that is very, very densely populated and would be easy to use, is a way for us to take care of our environment and take care of our community. And so, Rick, with the lawsuit, how could people expect to proceed?
Well, we've got a legal strategy, we've got a political strategy. The political strategy is what I mentioned. It is, you know, for us to have a reset of our priorities. I think people need to contact us. They could, you know, contact the Sierra Club or contact the Campaign for Sustainable Transportation, which is our website, campaignforsustainabletransportation.org, and get involved. We're organizing home meetings in people's backyards, where they invite, you know, a couple hundred neighbors. Not everybody's going to come, but they get the word out to their neighbors, hey, come to my house and learn about what we can do to stop this project. We're starting in Aptos with those house meetings. We'll be raising money for the lawsuit, because we still have to raise money.
How much do you expect to, what's the budget for your lawsuit?
Okay. Well, that gives me an opportunity to say we won our last lawsuit. So we the Sierra Club and the campaign, sued Caltrans over this environmental impact report that considered all the highway projects from Santa Cruz down to Freedom Boulevard, and we won. That EIR is invalid right now, and
Wait, can you explain what that means?
Okay, so the environmental impact report was supposed to, you know, it's the whole point is to provide the public with the with ideas about the impacts that on our environment, but also potentially alternatives to a project. And this EIR was invalidated by the California Superior Court because it did not have traffic study that was accounting for all the new traffic that would show up on an expanded highway. So the judge threw it out. So what we're saying as part of our lawsuit now is you can't build a small piece of that bigger project. If the master EIR is invalid, you can't just go ahead and build the smaller project. So that's one of our arguments in court.
Well, right, because I'm just here as an ordinary citizen, I'm sort of confused. I'm like, wait a minute, if the California Supreme Court said the EIR...
Superior Court.
Mm-hmm. Is invalid, then how does that environmental impact report get used?
Because so
I know they're very... Those EIRs
Caltrans
are very
got
important.
Tricky. They're trying to do an end run around that requirement. They're saying, oh, this is independent. We're not actually... just a small part of that bigger project. We're an independent. We have independent value, and so that's their argument. We'll see what the judge thinks.
We're special.
Sorry. Pretty much.
We're special. Yeah. We're going to talk a little bit more about this lawsuit that is being brought forward by the Campaign for Sustainable Transportation and the Sierra Club opposing the highway widening in Aptos. We'll be back with more on Talk of the Bay right after this short break.
Hi, I'm Bobby Bishop, host of Be in the Night, bringing you the best I can with jazz, love songs, and soul. Join me on Tuesday evenings from 7 to 10 p.m., playing the classics straight ahead and introducing you to the latest artists and composers. That's Tuesday nights from 7 to 10 p.m. right here on listener-supported KSQD 90.7 FM, Santa Cruz.
My name is Luigi Oviedo, owner-operator of Pleasure Point Computers and the host of The Computer Man Show, a one-hour call-in show Tuesdays at 6 p.m. Viruses, slowdowns, scams, and updates. Computers can be a pain, and I'll help you through it.
Send me an email with your request. If it's hardware you want, baby, I'm the best. I'm the computer.
If it has an on switch, we'll probably talk about it on The Computer Man Show Tuesdays at 6 p.m., only on KSQD 90.7 FM, Santa Cruz.
Get into a computer.
Hello, this is Melissa Martin, host of Under the Moon, where we jam out in the dark. We'll dance and chill out to a diverse mix of music, from house, reggae, electronic, Latin, and to so much more. Join me at midnight every Monday night here on The Squid. That is K-Squid 90.7 FM and KSQD.org.
All right, and then coming up in about 15 minutes, we have a special program on Moment of Truth, answering the question, who is Amy Chen Mills anyway? So Amy Chen Mills is the program's host, and tonight she is interviewed by Maylin Obinata. Amy Chen Mills has a background in journalism, spiritual psychology, and political activism. She is the author of 3 books, and she is going to discuss how to stay grounded in these very critical and troubling times and engage constructively with local and national politics, the climate crisis, and more. That's tonight, right here on KSQD at 6 p.m. Community Radio for the Monterey Bay. And now we will come back to our guests, Rick Longinotti and Lonnie Faulkner. We're talking, you know, equitable and reasonable and sensible transportation options for Santa Cruz County. And, you know, it is said in America that you get the justice you can afford. And so, Lonnie, you're nodding in a very chagrined kind of way. Lawsuits are, you know, goes back to ancient Greece, you know, like, how are we going to get our voice heard? Lawsuit. And unfortunately, it ends up being kind of an option of last resort because sort of public advocacy and, you know, conversation breaks down. Would you both speak to that? Lonnie, you want to speak to that? since you were nodding your head?
Well, I mean, I think it's a, we're very lucky to have Campaign for Sustainable Transportation and the Sierra Club and the power that wields with it, and the balance that can offset for people who come more from moneyed interests. But it's a shame that it ends up being that way. Right. You can do people power, grassroots. A lot of what we do is grassroots as well with Campaigns for Sustainable Transportation and Sierra Club. But when you're talking about deep pockets and highway widening, it's been such a long battle. You really have to bring out the big guns in order to make change.
Right. And you said the Sierra Club was supporting this. It has to approve it all the way to the national level, right?
Yeah.
It's a very powerful organization.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, when you just look at roadways and highway expansion in general over the decades, it has done so much damage environmentally. You hit on something that's really near and dear to my heart. I'm a biochemical endocrinologist by background, and that is that the toxic load alone is hugely impactful in our health, and people don't even think about the billions and billions of toxic tires. It's not just rubber. It's actually these cocktails of chemicals that are so toxic and deadly, resulting in cancers. And we look at why it increased cancers, why, gut dysbiosis, why endocrinology issues, where there's, you know, all these sorts of different offshoots of that. And so there's that component. Then we look at how expensive it is and environmentally impactful when you move wider and wider highways, what they call white flight, basically creating cities farther and farther, sprawl, basically urban sprawl, farther and farther from your city centrals instead of building more dense communities. Right. And that in and of itself resulted in an environmental impact. And then the separation and equity. So these white flights separated communities. It created entire communities that were unable to be successful and sustainable. And it caused systemization of racism and classism in our country. So our entire form of transportation in this country, you look at all these components and it is so destructive, and yet we haven't reckoned with that. And so it's taken this kind of approach that the Sierra Club and Campaign for Sustainable Transportation is like hammer over and over again. This is destructive. We need to stop.
Right. And I think often the average citizen, you know, we fail to comprehend how much the costs get externalized, the cost to our health, the cost to our mental well-being. It costs us money when our fellow citizens aren't doing well. You know, it costs all of us in so many ways, and yet that doesn't get quantified. And then, you know, our leaders will vote down something that's really positive and say, oh, it's, you know, we need 30 more million bucks and that's way too much money. And it's really hard for the average citizen to parse the real costs involved.
And it bankrupts cities as well. People don't realize this widening and sprawl actually bankrupts cities because it's more expensive to put in the plumbing and the electricity and everything out to these sprawling communities. And then over time, as you have to do maintenance, it's so much more expensive, right? So it's not just the building of the highways and the widening, it's the maintenance over time.
Right, and that was one of the things, the obstacles to the rail that often get cited. Oh, we can get the capital cost, but the maintenance, it's going to be so expensive. We surely can't handle that as a community.
And I'm like, so much cheaper.
Let's compare apples to apples. That storytelling is very important,
yes.
Is being able to show people these are the real costs side by side. These are the realities we're dealing with. So, Rick, you have anything to say to that?
Well, yeah. I mean, so I have a daughter who commutes to her job longer than she would like, you know, stuck in traffic. She spends about $800 a month on her car payments and then another, I don't know, a couple hundred dollars a month on an insurance. And then there's maintenance and gas. And, you know, it's like a big portion of her income. She cuts hair for a living, you know. We don't think of that, you know, when we think of like, oh, it's too much money to spend on transit. Well, what are we spending now? But it's all privatized. Like you said, it's just private spending. And that spending could be diminished. In San Francisco, the average household spends 9% of their income on transportation compared to 20% in Watsonville. That's because they got a great transit system you can get around.
Oh, I know. It's so fun.
Yeah.
Every time we go up to the city, we're like, let's just hop on Muni and see where we can go. It's a blast. I don't know why it's so fun, but I love I love public transit. I'm a public transit geek. Maybe listeners, you might have noticed that if you've listened to the Rail Trail series. But you know, as we wrap up, I want to just maybe talk a little bit about the care and concern and what goes into the Campaign for Sustainable Transportation. This is a grassroots organization that was started by ordinary folk who care. What's involved? How much time do y'all put in?
Yeah, well, we're proud that we sort of stand on the shoulders of people that went before. We, in Santa Cruz, around the late 60s and early 70s, there was a freeway planned right through Santa Cruz, right down King Street or California Street. They weren't sure which one they were going to choose. There was going to be a freeway down to the boardwalk. It would go down Ocean Street, come back on Chestnut. If you can imagine the destruction of homes and what that would do to the community. Well, it was stopped by the citizens. 1,500 citizens showed up at the meetings to weigh in on that. And finally, the city council asked the state of California to go away. And once again in 2004, that's when the Campaign for Sustainable Transportation was started by some Sierra Club members to fight a highway tax. So the tax would have, it was a sales tax, it would have, two-thirds of which would have gone to widen the highway for this big highway project. It was defeated everywhere in the county, in Watsonville to Scotts Valley. They needed two-thirds vote. They only got 43% of the vote. So we're really grateful for those folks. And actually, on May 3rd, we're having a tribute to some of those folks, Peter and Celia Scott, among others, as part of the film festival, the Real Works Film Festival.
Say a little bit. So there's a film going to be about that couple?
So yeah, the film is going to be about it's a PBS documentary about the nation's appetite for freeways and some of the resistance that happened back when. And then there'll be a tribute to the folks that were involved in these struggles. And that's going to be Friday, May 3rd at 7 p.m. at the Resource Center for Nonviolence.
Friday, May 3rd at the Resource Center for Nonviolence. And that sounds like a really fascinating and worthwhile film. I know a big part of my education growing up was watching these documentaries and understanding that every single thing that I love and treasure about my life was made possible because people stood up and said no to big money, big industry, and you know, the Uber barons of capitalism, you know, whether it's a 5-day work week, you know, 8-hour work day, you know, like blood, effort, passion. It's always these ordinary citizens that do it. And that's why I like to highlight these grassroots organizations and say, like, these folks put in a lot of time and a lot of effort and a lot of money, and our support for them in the community really makes a difference, right?
Thanks for the appreciation.
I just have to say Jane Jacobs comes to mind, who actually prevented, you know, she's one of my heroes. And there's a great video on Vimeo. I forget the name of the video, but I know we showed it at the
Citizen Jane
is so worth watching. Mm-hmm. You know, basically stop the highway from going through Central Park in New York. And you know, they just envisioned at one point, you know, having highways and freeways everywhere. And that kind of became a part of the mantra of the United States. And people like Jane Jacobs changed that.
Yeah, Jane and a handful of citizens really getting engaged there. Yes, in Greenwich Village. It's a really inspiring story. Please watch it, folks, and know that you make the difference. When you get involved, we can change things. I just was at the Bioneers Conference, and a really amazing election communicator, Anant Shankar Osorio, was talking about the fact that elections don't create change. It's agitation that creates change. We just want to elect people that will tolerate our agitation and not shut us down, but it's our agitation that creates change. So I want to, you know, thank you, Rick, and all the folks at the Campaign for Sustainable Transportation, Equity Transit, the Sierra Club. You know, we're all trying to work together to create a more equitable and functioning world to keep people safe and give us options as things are really intensifying on our planet. And we particularly, we need transit options.
Yeah, and I'll just tell a story. Mm-hmm. You know, so I used to drive over the hill to go to work. I worked in the biotech world, and I would contain everything in my car. I had a tent, I had a sleeping bag, I had food, I had water, everything I might need. I lived out of my car, and I also had a very lead foot. And it wasn't really until I started coaching kids, I coached mountain biking for 7 years, that really began to change my whole perception of how to drive in town. And it shifted my behaviors tremendously, just mm-hmm. being with the kids on the streets. And then also shifting my behaviors of trying to move away from driving as much towards using my bike as much as possible to get around town.
Yep, we can all change. So thank you, Rick. Thank you, Lonnie, for joining us on Talk of the Bay.
Thank you for having us.
Yeah. Thank you so much.
I'm Christine Barrington right here at KSQD in Santa Cruz, KSQD in Prunedale. We are at 89.5 and 89.7 up in the Monterey area, 90.7 in Santa Cruz. We are community radio for all of the Monterey Bay.